First page, welcome everybody. We are going to keep the idea of GC content, this biological part, GC content, and from the, well it's the part of the ideas of computational thinking. No? So the first idea, remember, is the composition. How to eat an elephant, you have to split it in smaller parts. The second question is, what do you do after you decompose? And we did the composition already in the exercise of writing things in English. No? So just to remind you, we are using this package called SeqInR to read sequences in R. We use it to load a FASTA file, and the FASTA file will give you a list. So, and in particular, a list with names. I will show you in a minute. A couple of details here. Remember that, I think if you are loading DNA, this is not critical, because if you don't say what is the kind of sequence, it will be automatically, by default, we say, will be DNA. But if you are loading proteins, then you have to say that the sequence type is AA, amino acid. Okay, and we are using this option essentially to make the class easier. We can explain that later. And the first thing that I recommend you doing is to check how many elements you get here with the command length. And this is useful because these are a lot of things. It's not something that is easy to print in the screen. If you want to see what is in genes, you will have a big screen and screen that is not necessarily something helpful for you. So at least to have an idea of what are you talking. And you can check if this makes sense. You can check, for example, with some paper or directly in NCBI, what is the expected length of the expected number of genes. The length of genes is the length of the list that contains all genes. Therefore, length of genes is meaning number of genes in this file, okay? I choose this name, FASTA Features Nucleotide. Some people will have a different name here. You just have to make sure, because when you go to NCBI, it's easy to get confused and get the genome instead of the genes, or get, for example, genes that are not coding. These are the coding genes, the protein coding genes, and in this particular strain of E. coli. Okay? Any question? No? Good. How we can go general? We did already. I mean, if you watch a class 3 that you should have watched before this class, you know that we can calculate the GC content of one gene, the first gene, okay? And then we are going to make it more general. We essentially apply the logic of the composition to calculate the GC content of every gene. We calculate one by one, okay? We calculate the first, then the second, and the third, which essentially we know how to do, essentially, no? So we assume that we have the genes in a list called genes, and we use read FASTA, so this is a list. So I hope you read the class 3, because it's half of this class. Remember, the strategy we use in this course is that as much as I can, I will give you the content before, so we have time to practice. We use the Friday class. In theory, the Friday class is half-time theory and half-time practice, so we need time to practice, and therefore we need to teach more theory outside. So in class 3, we saw this solution. Okay, I gave you it twice here, but okay. I went too obsessive, but the logic is this. You take the genes and you make it uppercase. Sorry, I made it twice here. Then this is just to guarantee that even if the genome is reading in lowercase, you will still be able to see it. Then we use this construction to count how many times you have C and how many times you have G. Okay? If you don't understand this, now is the time to ask, because I am assuming that everybody understand what are we writing here.
Can you explain a little bit more, please?
Yes, yes, yes. We start, V is the first gene, and in this case, it corresponds to a vector of letters, okay, a vector of characters. In this command here, in this expression, we are comparing all elements of the vector with the letter C. Since this is a comparison, you will have either true or false. The letter is a C or is not a C. There are no other options. It is C or it's not a C. And then you will have a vector of true or false. For every letter in V, you will get true if it's equal to C and false if it's not equal to C. And then the trick is here. The command sum, when it's applied over logic vectors, essentially take all the trues as one and all the false as zero. In other words, this counts, you should read this command, this function, as how many times, count how many times the vector V has the letter C. Okay? How many elements in this vector are equal to C? This is something we're going to use a lot in this class, so I want to explain it carefully. This is how we count a particular case. There was a proposition of using the command table, which, to be honest, I believe it was good until I found that there were some cases that was not good. And that is explained in the class. So for the first gene, we got 51% of the GC content. For the second, we get 53. And then for the third, 56. For the fourth, for the number five, number six, and you should keep doing it. What do you think about this strategy? Do you like the idea of doing it one by one, copy and paste, copy and paste? I mean, even when I do copy and paste, I made a mistake here. So this is boring. And the deal is that computers do the boring thing, and we do the thing that computers cannot do. That is our deal with the computer. We do the creative part, they do the boring part. And everybody's happy. So the powerful tool here is pattern recognition. And remember, computational thinking, we say had decomposition, pattern recognition, abstraction, and algorithm, algorithm design. So what is the pattern here? Compare the first and the second. What do they have in common? Or in other words, what is the difference? The same question, no? What do they have in common? What is the difference?
Genes number are different, I think, just.
Yeah. And the rest?
The same.
The same. Do you agree? Move your heads or speak.
Yeah, I agree.
Good, good. You see, Meral is talking, and Sedat and Kubra are silent. We don't know if they are there or just ghost. So when we say pattern recognition, it's subtle because a pattern is not something that is identical. These two codes are not the same, but they are very much the same. I mean, we have a saying, is they are not identical, but they are the same. They're not the same thing, but they are very much the same. How we find? So the basic idea of pattern recognition is that you see that they are very similar, except for minor changes, and we identify what is the minor change. So in general, we can say that the phrase that we, the code that we are writing is something like this. And there is this something here. Something that we will use to, how can we say, we can use to decide which is the gene. So so we can kind of capture this idea. try to make a summary, and the only thing that changed is this. So we decomposed the problem initially in the last class, since we wrote all these steps. Then we recognized the pattern, the solution for first gene and solution for second and so on are more or less the same. Now we are going to abstract. And this is a word that is, I always have problem explaining because nobody could tell me what is the word in Turkish. When I speak about abstract, people think about the abstract of a paper, but this is not the same concept of abstract. Abstract in this sense means kind of what is the general idea, what is the essence of the problem, and you forget about the details. So the essence here is that all the code except which is a particular gene, which is the particular gene. That is the detail that we want to forget. Essentially, abstraction means that you see the big picture and you forget the details. So let's talk about function. This is one of the ways that we do abstraction, kind of speaking, trying to see the big picture, okay? So if you want, it can look contradictory because we say that we are going to decompose. Yeah, that is kind of the analysis part. And this part, we are going to make a synthesis of what is all these steps, we put them back together in a way that allow us to make it more general. Maybe I should say that the reason we do abstraction is because when we forget about the details, then we have a tool that is able to solve general problems. So let me say this one. Let me go back one second. Here, we have a code that can calculate the GC content of the first gene and only the first gene. And that is very specific. This code can calculate GC content for the second gene and only the second gene. But this one can calculate the code for any gene. And we want to wrap this, encapsulate, put in a pill that we can use again. So these are the questions that we want to say. How you write a function, what are the parts, and how many of each part? Okay, so let me show you. To make your own functions, we are going to use this shape. So it's again an assignment. So the variable has a name. It's the same like way that we assign a number, but we are going to assign a function. So somehow functions are a kind of values. Like you can assign a vector, or you can assign a list or a data. You can also assign a function. And that is interesting. So you use this particular command. This is a keyword. The word function is a word that has a special meaning in R, and we can only use it to make functions. Then immediately after, we put in parentheses one or more variables that are going to be the input. So remember, a function is kind of a black box that takes some one or more inputs and produce one output. Some guys don't, but in general, you should think 99% of time, you have one or more inputs and one output, okay? So there are four parts. The name of the function, you have to think a name of the function. The input, what are the things that are going inside? What are the commands, which right now is the only part that we know? And what is going to be the output of the function? Okay?
Okay.
Good. Did I go too fast? No, this is the function. No, fine. No, not skipping anything. What is the function? So what I did here, let's take as much as we need to understand this. You may recognize that this is exactly what we did before. Okay? This is the same code that we get in the class number 3. and that we discussed in the slide number 3 or so. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah, and everybody see this? Okay. So, and the only change is that instead of saying something, I put I. I can put anything here. I can put, I can choose a name. There is a, if you like, tradition or a best practice, if you like, that if you are using an index, you use I because it's the letter of index, okay? I mean, you, for example, you may remember that when people do vectors and matrices, you have I and J for the row and column of the matrix. That's a thing that are conventions, okay? So it has the advantage that if you follow it, you don't need to think very much about it because you know that I is going to be an index. Like X, the horizontal, and Y, the vertical. These are conventions and help you make your life easier. So the name of the function, I had to put a name, and I called GinGC content version 1. And that should give you a hint that there will be more versions. Normally we don't put version name, but I'm putting for this class so we can see the difference between this version and when we make it a little better. Then you may not see immediately, but there is no a clear output. There is not a command to give the output. Maybe you can see because the keyword for the output is this one. This is another keyword, return. So I am giving you two keywords, function and return, okay? Return is a command that will indicate what is the output of the function, okay? And in this function that we wrote, we don't have a clear output here, okay? And this will, if I'm not wrong, Zeynep asked last year, last semester, why we use print. Yeah. Why we have to use print here? And the reason is here, because if we don't use print here, if you just put the variable name in the function, but you don't use print, you will not see it. So in the last semester, when we didn't use function, there was no difference between using GC content or print GC content. But inside a function, there is a difference. And that is why we show print. It took me several months to answer the question, but now you see that. You can try. You can write this and see what happened. Let me show you what happened, but you can try to see what happened if we don't show it. Well, we will see. It is subtle. It is subtle, not very evident. But so now we can do GC content for gene 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And okay, we are still copying and pasting, but at least it's shorter. Okay? And you can easily see how you can use for other things. Fine? So so far the idea is not complicated. We take something that we want to do many times and we put it in an envelope and give it a name. And to make it interesting, the result should depend on the input because if you get always the same result, it's probably a boring thing and you do it only one time. But since you want to use it in several times, for example, in several genes, you need to put something like this one. Okay? So there is a little detail that I want to save this number. For example, if I want to make a plot, I want to plot the GC content through all the genome. In fact, I didn't make that. That will be a question. Like you go gene by gene following the genome and you want to see if the GC content follows some shape. Okay, this is going to, we are going to do it often. Okay, it's going to be important. What if we don't, what if we want to store them? So what were we doing here? Remember C is the command that we use to make a vector. So this is a vector that I take the answer for number one, number two, until number five, the first five genes, and we try to put them in a vector. And they got here, so it's not so bad. But we have a secondary effect that is essentially not what we want, that the numbers get also printed. So what's happening here is something like, we should be clear who is the owner of the data or who is doing the things. The function that we make is printing without our permission. We will like a function that we decide when to print things and when not to print things, okay? At the end, many things about function is like a contract. You know, there are two people here making a deal. One person is saying, one person is creating the function and the other person is using the function. And we have to have an agreement. What is the part that you do? What is the part that I do? And in this case, the agreement should be like the function calculates things but doesn't print anything. And we get the numbers and we decide if we are going to print, we are going to plot, we are going to save them, we are going to do some statistic. So we should not have a function that prints. We should have a function that only returns. And this is the version two. That is why we have a version one and version two. Okay. And the only change is that instead of print, we have return. Okay. So in some sense, print and return are similar in the sense that they take a number and they give it to something else. The difference is this: when you do print, the value is sent to the screen immediately. And you may want to save it for later. You may want to have the flexibility of when to show it, when not to show it. If instead you say return, you are not printing anything, but when the function finishes, it will give you the value as the output of the function. Okay? So now I'm going to show you the same code that we had before, this one. This is a variable and we are making a vector and we get the nice number as we expected, but there is nothing printed in between, okay? So this function is kind of, how can I say, more low profile, if you like. It's like, it's not like screaming, like, I am doing this. No, it's doing something. You do your job and you deliver the thing. And we, the user, we decide later what to do with the content. The function take the gene number and give a result. And that's it. OK? Question? Nilbe is sleeping.
No question.
So in general, we are going to do like this. In fact, well, I have a summary later, but let me go back 1 second just to make sure that we are looking at the same. This is the shape that you have to keep in mind. This is slide number 15. If you want to remember one of there are two ideas in this class. This is one of the ideas of this class. How you write a new function, this is the shape. You have to put a name, and you have assigned a function to this name, and you declare what are the input, you put the commands, and then you finish saying return output, okay?
Teacher, can I ask something about this slide?
Of course.
You are saying that input can be zero or more.
Yeah.
What kind of conditions the input can be zero?
Ah, very good question. That is the question that I was expecting that someone made. There is only one case that makes sense to me, is when you are, technically they are never zero, but sometimes that input is something outside the program. For example, when you ask what time is it, the function that give you what is the time doesn't take any input from us. But the real input is a clock going to the computer. The computer has an internal watch and it's asking what time is it and giving you the time. Or let's say that you have a sensor and you are measuring a temperature. Okay, so what I am saying is that zero in the sense that you don't write them here. But you are right, the function is going from somewhere. There should be an input somewhere, okay? What I'm saying essentially is that the input is implicit. That is kind of, if you don't say it, they will guess automatically and will go to reach a sensor or something like that. So yeah, technically all functions have at least one input, but sometimes we don't write it. Okay, they have an input, but sometimes we don't write it because it's kind of automatic. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
That is a good question. I expected someone to. Yeah, from the mathematical point of view, I will love to say that all functions need at least one input. But in the computer, sometimes we don't write that input. Okay? From the mathematical function, always have at least one input, maybe more. But from the computer point of view, we have only one. From the computer, we can have zero. Okay. Remember that the slides have a number. And if you have questions, you can always write the number of the slide and ask, in slide number 15, you say this. And now you are saying this. Why? Okay, so this here we see the same pattern. No, we have the name, we have the function, we have the input, we have the commands, and we have the output. In fact, the keyword return is we are using especially to make sure that you see what is the output. It make it easy to recognize what is the output. Okay, it's to make sure that we understand. Okay, so how we will go further, how we will do this for all the genes? How we can apply this function to each element of the list? There are 4,140. Do you want to copy and paste? I mean, I can copy and paste 5, but not 500 or 5,000. I will get cramps. So you know the logic, no? We want to. So one question will be, maybe we can put a vector here, or the list. Maybe we can put the list. What happens if we do that? So let me give a first view. Some functions that we have seen before are a vector to vector, in the sense that if you give a vector, that will give you back a vector of the same size. For example, if you ask square root of all these numbers, this is essentially taking the square root of the first, square root of the second, of the third. So some functions have this property, that if you give several numbers, they apply the rule to each one independently. Okay? That's something good in general, because you don't need to go one by one. You can give the vector and they get the square root of the vector. Or the square root of the logarithm of 1 to 3, the exponential of 1 to 3. Okay. In fact, you may remember when we did linear models, we did the coefficient. And the coefficient was a vector. And then we took the exponential of the coefficient. So we took the exponential of a vector. So let me say this way. The exponential of a vector is the vector of the exponential. Okay? The exponential. The square root of the vector is the vector of the square roots. The logarithm of the vector is the vector of the logarithm. Okay? The point is normally we take only one element, square root of one number or logarithm of one number. That is why we don't see this before, but if this vector has one element, this is just the normal square root or the normal log. Well, I'm afraid to say that our function will not work like this. Okay? There is a second kind of functions that we will take a look later that take one vector and give you one value, like minimum, maximum. They are kind of summary. They are reducing the vector to something smaller. Okay, it's a difference. So you have functions that are one to one or many to many, if you like, many to many, and the others that are many to one. And we want like our function to be like that. We would like to give a vector or a list of genes and get a list of codes or something like that. So, but if we try to do that and we give a vector 1, 2, 3, we get an error because our function is not really working like that. Unfortunately, we cannot. The way that we design it, it's assuming that you get one because we have one index. So we can think the function a little different, but I will not do that because, I mean, it will be longer and I prefer to see the big solution. And this is the second concept of today's class. Okay, this is the second idea. We have a function that we can use to apply a vector. Okay, let me say that. This is a super function, if you like, that can apply a function to each element of a vector. It's called L-apply. L because it will give you a list. Okay? Let's take all time that we need to understand this. So here we have the first input will be a vector or a list, something with several elements. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? And then in the second part, Laplace takes a function that we defined before or something, okay? And what you do, what Laplace do very efficiently is that it applies this function to the first, to the second, to the third, to the fourth, to the fifth, and give you the list.
Can I ask something? Yeah.
Yes, of course.
If we don't write 1, 5, 1 to 5, okay. Okay. What will happen?
Well, the first part of Laplace should be a list or a vector. So you need to write something there. You cannot use this function without saying where. Like you are saying, over these objects, apply this function. You are combining two things, like a set of elements and a function. Okay, you need to have a set of elements where you will apply the function. What will be the alternative? What is in your mind? If we do apply without,
I want to apply all of genes.
Well, then we have to say all of genes. We have to say all of genes because the Laplace doesn't know.
For example, from 1 to a length of genes.
Exactly, exactly. Oh,
okay.
Exactly. Yeah, you see, you got it. Yeah, but just one comment. Did you see what happened that Zeynep asked a question, but was not the real question that she had. The real question was how we do this over all the genes. And then you ask it like, will Laplace guess what is the set of all genes? Well, Laplace, let me say, has no idea of genes. Laplace has no idea what is happening here. If you see, and this is the problem of this solution, I will show you why I don't like this. In a minute, I will show you. But the problem is that we don't see the genes anywhere here. You don't see the genes here, and that is not very good. The genes, how we know the genes here? The genes are implicit in the function. When we made the function, let me go back to the function. Here, inside the code of the function, we are using the variable genes that we created before. But they are super hidden. That is probably something that we should change. We should not have the genes hidden. Because it will make it, the way that we are doing, it works only for E. coli, only for the genes of E. coli. And we want to make it more general. Remember, usually we want our code to work in general cases because, I mean, if you solve it for E. coli and tomorrow you are working in Saccharomyces cerevisiae, will you write everything again? Or you would like to have a tool that works in every case? You probably want a tool that works always. So, Laplay will give you a list. You get a vector. This can be a vector or a list. Okay, something that you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then the function, no parentheses here. This is a function name, but without parentheses. Okay. This is important because when we say a GNGC content and with parentheses, we are using the function. Here we are not using the function, we are just giving the name of the function. Okay. If I say square root of parentheses 2, I am calculating the number. But if I say square root, I am speaking about the function that takes numbers and give you another number. So this is, if you like, an abstract idea of how to calculate a GC content. Okay, now, this is the most generic version. And there is something important to know here. This can be very fast for the reason that if your computer has several processors, this can be done in one processor, and this can be done in another processor at the same time, and this in another, and this in another. So modern computers have several processors, multi-core, like 8 cores or sometimes 16 cores or something like that. And if you do it correctly, your code can use all of them instead of using one, like the first, the second, the third, the fourth, instead of going like side to side, they go in parallel. And that essentially make it 16 times faster. That essentially means that instead of taking half day, it take 1 hour, let's say. If they are taking 15 minutes, it take 1 minute. It's the kind of thing that, I mean, you can make more tests. And even if you make an error, you will realize later, this happened to me. Let me tell you a story. Many years ago, I was working in a project by informatics with a big company and so. And we had to design a microarray. And I had a program that took some time. And well, I make the program run and I got the result the next day. My program was running in 32 processors. So essentially, if I do it in one processor, it will take 1 month. But in 32 processors, it take 1 day. That was the difference. Doing in parallel reduced from 1 month to 1 day. And the day after, when I got the result, I realized that I made a big mistake. Instead of taking the correct DNA strand, I was taking the complementary. And that will mean that nothing will work. I was taking the wrong, because the microarray, you know, work by hybridization. And if you have the wrong strand, they don't hybridize. So I had to do it again. And I do it. It took me one extra day. And it was fine because, I mean, if I tell my partner that it will take me one extra day, they will say, okay. But if I say after 1 month, they say, I'm sorry, I need another month to do it correctly this time, they will kill me. So doing things fast give you permission to make mistakes. That is the point. You can test several ideas and see what works and what doesn't work. And this is something that you get with this kind of function. Later, we will see a more traditional way that doesn't have as much power. And by the way, you are the first generation that learned this. So you have a big advantage. Essentially, the point is that this function can be done in any order, from 1 to 5 or 5 to 1, some order. You don't know in which order they are going to be, but you don't care because they are all independent. Sometimes they are not independent. We will see that case later. But in this case, every GC content of every gene is independent of the others. Okay? Now, sometimes you want a simple version. So to be honest, this is a function that I mostly use. Is instead of L apply is S apply. S meaning simple. Essentially, S apply is the same as L apply, but instead of giving you a list, it tries to give you a vector. Sometimes it cannot and will give you a list in that case. I will like us in the second part when we do the exercise, I would like us to try to do this.
So we can plot.
We can plot, yeah. We will. In fact, yeah, we are essentially in the condition that we can do that. Maybe we should try to do that. I'm going to use it right now directly in the concept. We are not writing a document yet. Maybe later. We need to get the sequence. I have my sequence somewhere here, so I'm going to do this. I'm going to start with library seq in R, okay, which I installed previously. Then I'm going to load the genes. In fact, we can look at the slides number. Well, we did at the beginning, no? Do you remember what we say? We say genes. What should I do now?
Read faster.
Okay, read faster. And now, okay, here in my computer, I have stored this in a folder. So I remember this NC, this is the FFN. Okay, I use a tab. And tab give me all the options. Remember, tab is your friend. Every time that I don't remember something, I press tab. This is the one that we will check later. And we say sequence seq type. I press tab, you see, seq type equal DNA. And the other was something with S.
What was the option?
Set attribute, that one. Okay. False. Okay, and we got genes. So, and we see here that there are 4,140, but if you don't want to see there, we see length of genes. That was the way that we recommended to see what is happening here. If you want, you can click here and you can see that. And in fact, sorry, here you see that they have names. So if we say genes, the first three, for example, 1, 2, 3. They are a lot, you see. But each one is with a dollar sign, showing that they have the names. Okay, I'm clearing the screen. Control L will clear the screen. Okay, so we have the genes. And we need to write the function. I can copy and paste. Maybe it will be faster if I just copy and paste from the slides. So, but just to make sure that we are all talking about the same thing. I write it here. I don't know if you can see, but here when I put the cursor, this vertical bar in the closing, the opening parenthesis is marked. It's a way to verify that everything that I, every time that I open something is also being closed, okay? One of the typical errors, and it's very common, is that we open a parenthesis and then we forget to close it, or we close it and we forget to open it. The balancing the parenthesis is a typical error that we should be, we have to be careful on that detail, you know? I mean, I always say that this course is about the big ideas. But at the end of the day, you need to do it carefully. It's like It's like when you do an experiment, you have a lot of theory and a lot of practice and a lot of things, but at the end of the day, you have to do the experiment carefully. Okay, let's see what happens. So GNGC content, and we've got, look, here in the environment, in the memory, we get the large list and a function. And this is the input. Okay? So we see them here, and you can even click, probably can see here what is the function. Okay, too much. Anyway, let's go. So we say, just to test gene GC content version 2 of the gene number 1, and number 10, and number 100. And yeah, as you realize, it will be super boring. Just to try the idea, what we do, 1 to 5, let's say. Error, it doesn't work with, it take one number, not a list. But then you learn the super command, we say Laplay. Laplay, as we say, is we will check this with more detail. Maybe, well, let's do it now. I press F1 now, and I see the help. You know that when you are writing, you can press F1, and like here it says, press F1 for additional help. Well, we get the answer here. You say X function, and then there are others. You will read later. But remember, every function that we use has a help page. And I am not telling you all the details because, I mean, the class is short, but there are many other things that may be useful. Simplified through, anyway. Lapply. What are we doing here? 1 to 5, we say, and then the function. What is the function? Gene GC content. And that will result in a list. Okay. The problem is that sometimes we want lists, depending on the problem. Sometimes we want a list, sometimes we want something else like a vector. If Sapply can simplify, we will get a vector like this. And then when we have a vector, we can have from 1 to 50 to 500, and we get the 500 genes. If I use Sapply from the 1 to 5, it's calculating the GC content of gene 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I say Sapply 1 to 5,000, no, 500, then I will get the GC content of gene 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, blah, 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 until 500. Okay? And now if I want all, I will assign them, because it will be a lot, all GC genes, no, all genes, well, whatever. GC, maybe GC of all genes, let's say. GC of, that is a better name. GC content of all genes, how we will do that? We assign, we say supply. What I should write now?
From 1 to length of genes, then function name.
Yeah, everybody agree? Anybody disagree with this question? Length of genes is the length of this list, which correspond essentially to the number of genes, okay? And it takes a couple of seconds. And you got the result here. Okay, a new value. And we can plot. Yep. It's not a very beautiful plot, in part because we have too many circles. So, okay, let me make a sum and see if this is a little easier to understand. Ah, in fact, I have a, okay. I remember that I made a plot of this, but we will see later. You see that most of them are near this center and there is some kind of upper and lower. So one question that brings you back to biology is why you have a gene with very low GC content or very high GC content. You see, like the normal behavior is moving around center point here. Why some of them are very different? Why they are atypical? Then that is the reason why we do this. We are not doing this just because we like using the computer. We like using the computer, but at the end of the day, we want to use this for doing biology. So what is the biological meaning of this? Do you have any idea of why a particular gene will be so different from the rest?
Maybe mutations.
Okay, but you need a lot of mutation to change the GC content. I mean, mutation kind of move you here. But okay, good hypothesis. I have other two hypotheses.
Can it be poly tail maybe?
For this example, is a bacteria. This is a bacteria. They don't have poly. But yeah, it could have been in other. I mean, it would be a good question. You raise a question like, if we do this with yeast, will it look similar or not? Let me just give one comment. The computer analysis will not answer this question, but will help you to find this question. It will help you to identify genes that are, have something different. I am asking you to think like a biologist now. What will you say is the issue here? You are free to think. The mutation is an idea. Poly A, the point is poly A, yeah, some of them may have, no? But if you have poly A, you should have a GC content a little lower, but they are not so long. And the genes, what is the length of a gene? Do you know? In bacteria, let's say. There's some intuition that are good to have. We will check it later. In a few minutes, we will check it. But my rule of thumb is that a gene is around 1,000 nucleotides on average. They're shorter and longer, of course, but on average. And a reason for thinking that is that we have 4,000 genes in a genome of 4 million letters in E. coli, for example. So on average, like a very big picture, in bacteria, one gene is around 1,000. Sometimes shorter, sometimes longer, but on average, around 1,000. So, and the poly A are probably 6 letters, and will not, on average, unless the gene is very short. Yeah, if the gene is very short, like 70 nucleotides, then it can be 10%, yeah. So yeah, this may be a short gene. Any other theory? Let me remind you that in the first class, I show you the scientific method, and I say that, in my opinion, the most important thing that you have to do is to have questions, have good questions. So my question is, why this happened? Okay, then the second part is try to guess. Let me give you one idea. Horizontal transfer. Yeah. You know that, I mean, the you should know that bacteria sometimes interchange genetic material. Maybe you have just a plasmid, that the bacteria got a plasmid, and the plasmid eventually got integrated, or a virus. Somehow you have something that if one of these doesn't look like the rest, I mean, if you have a lot of cats and then you have a dog, something happened there, no? A dog in between cats, something happened. But there I have another theory. It is related to replication. Okay, this is more subtle, but when the chromosome replicate, for the chromosome replication, it has to open. And something that we know is that in general, the replication origin has very low GC content. Why? Why the replication origin has low GC content? Why GC content is important?
Scientists realize that this, but I don't know. When they plot, they realize that GC content is low in the replication origin. Then,
yeah, maybe this is close to replication origin. Yeah, Well, depending on how you think about it, but the reason that I have in mind is this: GC are bound by three hydrogen bonds. They are connected with three hydrogen bonds and AC with two. Therefore, separating GC is harder than separating AT, okay? So if you have a part of DNA that you want to open easily, you better have low GC. And the replication origin is the part that you want to open you start opening the chromosome. So low GC content suggests that the cell will be split there. There is an advantage from the evolution point of view to say that the cells that have high GC content have more trouble replicating than the cells that have low GC content in the replication origin. You do it 10 million times. 10 million times for bacteria is not a lot of time. You remember that E. coli replicate every 20 minutes. So in 10 million times, the one that can replicate faster win. They have more and more success, and they are more and more, the lower the GC content in the replication origin, the faster you can replicate, the less energy you need, the higher. You can even see that there's kind of a dip here, no? A kind of, well, maybe it's optical illusion. But all these things are things that we can investigate later, and we can investigate because we got this thing. But what I'm essentially trying to show you is that we do this sequence statistic not only because we like using the computer, also because we want to do biology. Doing analysis of DNA helps you to understand what's happening. Help to say, okay, this gene is different. Why is different? You go, you see it, and you can design an experiment. You say, okay, maybe this is replication origin. How will I test this? Maybe this is horizontal transfer. How will I test this thing? This is, in general, how we make discoveries. Most of the genes are like this, but oh, look, there is one that is very high GC content. Why? Then you go, and that is how we discover things. So
can I ask something at this point? Can it be experimental fail, maybe?
Yeah, it can be. Yeah, true. It's true. It is a very, very good point. Yeah, so in general, what will happen is this. When you do real experiment, you will have that most of your results are exactly what you expect, and some of them are completely unexpected. Some of them are completely unexpected. And then you have the big trouble. Either you make a big mistake or you made a big discovery. And then is when things become interesting. So Yeah, but it's a problem every time that someone make a discovery, you have to convince people that it's really a discovery and not a mistake. And both happen, you know, people have made mistakes, people publish discoveries and later realize they are mistakes, and people make discoveries. So, but this is the business that we are here. We are in the business of discovery, and we want to make sure that this is not a mistake. That is why we are very careful. That is why it's important that you follow the protocol carefully and you get the correct calibration and you get the good temperature and the computer code is well done. It can be even a computer error. I mean, if we make a mistake in our code, and that happens, that people get. Okay, this is another story, but in 1995, Intel, the processor maker, got the super new one. It was very expensive and very powerful, the Pentium, famous Pentium. They invest a lot of money. And after a while, people start finding people doing science because it was super powerful, super expensive. So the first people who buy was people doing very advanced science, and they found that there were some errors. And what they found is that the chip, the processor, was wrong. There was 1% of division that were wrong. There was some error in the chip that when you divide a number by another, you get the wrong number. And it was a big, big problem. Like people realized that they cannot trust the computer. The code was correct, but the computer was telling a wrong answer. And it was something like this. They discovered that was wrong and they had to trace back why it's given different. So they tested a different computer and they found that the result was different and they traced the error to the hardware. That is what makes science so interesting. You never get bored here. Well, unless you are doing the same thing 100 times, no? But if you do if you let the computer do the boring stuff, you can do all the interesting and amazing stuff. Okay, what I want to finish with this, I will do just again GC of all genes. It took 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds. 4,140 genes, like 100 genes per second. Not bad versus copying and paste, no? What I'm trying to sell you is the idea of S-apply or L-apply. So how we do the same thing, we will see this problem more and more because well, it was because it's the nature of the business here. But the first strategy that we have is like, what is the thing that we want to solve? How we decompose it? We make a code, we put that code in a function, and we apply it to everything. Okay? Apply, it will be one of the super tools that we have. Applying the same function to many things. If you read on the internet, this is called mapping. There's in many languages it's called map. Like you have, I don't know what it's called map, what's connected with the maps of cities, but it's like you have one set here and you make a map of one thing in the other. You point each one to each one. You have kind of one vector of input and then one vector of output, 1-to-1. Map. One of the super concepts. Okay. What if we want to calculate the GC of all the genome? Not of only the gene, all the genome. What is the GC? Well, we started the question. What is the GC content of E. coli? You know that the first thing that people do when they find a new bacteria is to calculate the GC content to see if this is something new or something different. The first step that you do when you want to classify a new bacteria is to calculate GC content. Okay? How we do that? Okay, this is a little longer, but not very much. We will read this file, okay? And here I want to take a minute because this is a typical error that people make, that when we read the FASTA, we always get a list. We don't get the genome, we get a list of chromosome. In bacteria, there usually is one chromosome, okay? But it may be more. You may have plasmid or whatever. The point is, you don't get the genome, you get the chromosomes, and then you have to choose which chromosome you are going to analyze. Okay? So even if you have one, it's always a list. You always get a list of genes. Okay, let's copy and do this thing. Okay, I am assuming that you know how to get these sequences, okay? Then chromosome data. So I have to change something here. I have to put in I have in my folder. So it takes a few seconds. 37 megabytes, a large list. One chromosome. So what the genome of this organism will be the first chromosome. Double bracket, remember, it's a list. We need double bracket to extract the first element. Okay. Now genome is a large vector of character with 4 million six. So this is the thing. When we say length of genome is a vector now. So the length of the genome is the number of nucleotides in the chromosome. And we have length of length th of genes, which is the number of genes. And you get that on average in E. coli, in this version of E. coli, the gene length is 1,121 on average. So yeah, it's not 1,000, but it's close to 1,000. It's not 500, it's not 2,000. It's around 1,000 in bacteria. In eukarya, probably is much less because I don't know. In fact, yeah, the genomes are. There is another point that I didn't tell you. In fact, I am cheating here because in bacteria, almost 95% of the genome is gene. The junk DNA is very little. Okay, in bacteria, most of the genome is gene. Okay, that sounds like homework question. What percentage of the genome is a gene? Okay, we'll do it later. Anyway, what we're saying is this. How we calculate the GC content? We have now this, let me show you, genome is very long, 4 million. So let me just show you from 100. These are the first letter of the genome. How we calculate the GC content?
Should we create a new function?
We can create a new function, but then will we create a function every time that we need a new organism?
I think new function is not necessary for this because we have just one genome. Not so many.
But one day we may have more than one genome. We may have, what if I give you a list of bacteria, and I want you to classify the GC content of all bacteria. It's not very hard to do. You see, you can download all the, from the NCBI, you can select a series of bacteria and you download all the genomes and you read with read FASTA, and then you can calculate the GC content of each one. It's not a hard homework, and it makes sense. Okay, let me give you a particular example, what I have in mind. Most of my work is in metagenomics. And in metagenomics, you will have a lot of sequence, maybe short, a lot of reads, if you like, from environment. And you will have many of them, and you will like to classify them. So the first thing that we will do is to calculate GC content of them. Because if you can separate low GC content from high GC content, you can say, okay, here we have two different groups of bacteria and we can process them separately. Something like that. So yeah, we want to make a function that can work not only with the genes of E. coli, I want a function that works with any sequence. So, a first approach is how we calculate without a function. If you say like without a function, we can take the same code that we have before. We take genome, we make it uppercase, and we use the same code. This is the number that we should get, okay? This is a particular case, like, but you will be every time doing again and again the same thing, boring. So what I am proposing is this. This is my third version. And I hope that you remember that, but here I take directly a vector of the sequence. I take only the sequence. In this version, we don't speak about gene. We don't speak about genome. We just say sequence. It can be anything, any sequence. Okay? I got rid of the gene part. We only input a sequence. The only detail here that I have to make sure that is uppercase. I get it to uppercase. And then I calculate the rest is the same code that you have before. But if you see here, we don't say gene anymore. So let me show you how this works. Are you okay with this? What is the question? I see question marks in some faces.
I have something. So we should write like V is genome or V is gene every time.
When we use the function. Remember, there are two people here. One is the person writing the function, and the other is the person using the function.
Okay.
I agree that usually we are the same person, physical person, but you do it in different moments of your life. Or let's be honest, when we use the function, read FASTA, for example, someone created that function for us. We don't need to be the same person. We don't need to do everything. We take the package already made. So here we are saying the contract is this. Let me say the contract. The user will give us a sequence. The function will receive a vector of a sequence, and in exchange, we are going to give one number that will correspond to the GC content. Okay? Yes, no? Maybe?
Yes, okay.
We are not asking now a gene number, we are asking for a sequence. So, how we use it? We can say gene GC content of the genome, and you get the number. or you can apply, and look what we did here. Remember, genes is a list, and apply, supply, and apply can take a vector or a list. This is, to me, the most beautiful part. You take the list, and you apply the function to every element of the list. And you remember that the list has names. Okay? Every element of the list had a name, which was the name of the gene. The output also has name. Let me compare this. I don't have it immediately here, but let me compare this output with the previous one. I don't have it so much at hand. This one. This is the version 2. So we have gene 1, gene 2, but you don't know which is the name of gene 1. You are calling it student number 1, student number 2, student. You are not using proper names. And if when you do supply in this, you get a vector, but these things don't have name. They are numbers. I mean, they work fine, but they don't have any name. You don't have any context. In the new version, we abstracted one level higher. Our code doesn't say gene, doesn't say genome. It just say, you give me a sequence and I will give you a GC content. That sequence can be a gene, can be a genome, and you can have gene or genome. And moreover, when you get a list with names, the output will have names also. That is why it took me so long to make this slide. All the genes, you see? Fine?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand, because how is we is connected to the genome? I mean, how does the computer understand that and replace it with the genome?
Because we tell here in the input, we say calculate the GC content of the genome.
Okay, so genome is like V here, because we put it instead of V, we put genome.
Exactly. Yeah, that is the point. Okay. Very good. Yeah, very good. Very good. Very good. That's what I wanted to get. So again, this is a contract. So internally, inside the business, we call it V. We will get something that we will call V. And we will do everything with V. We will make uppercase and we compare and everything. Okay? Then, when we use it, the other part of the business, the user, give a value to V. It can be the genome, it can be a gene, it can be anything. And this, in fact, is not very different. Let's see. It's not very different from this version. Let's say no, version this one. Here we have I was our input, a letter I, and we use the letter I here. Okay, so from the function point of view, you know that someone is going to tell you what is the value of I. It's not my job as a function to know I. My role is to know what to do with I. So I is an input. Someone will tell me. I just assume that someone told me and I do something with I. Then the user has, by the contract, the user has to tell you different values for I. And the function will react for different values of I. Okay? Okay, we will.
Thank you.
We will go back. We will go back to this question because it's the key, one of the typical points that Your function should, in fact, I made a mistake in the same. Your function should work, should use the input. You don't make the input, you use the input, you don't change the input. So, okay, we are going to, but this is the plot that I was making for the class. When we apply the function to all the genes, we can make a histogram, which essentially, if you like, is another view of this thing. You see that the most of them are around some center value, and some are up, some very few are low, some are high. So from if you look from the side, in another perspective, what you get is this histogram. Very few are very low, some are very high, most of them follow this shape. Okay? And then I am adding a vertical line with the GC content of the genome. So what can we say about this? What I will say is that most of the genes have a GC content around the average, which is not surprising. I mean, at the end, the genome is made by a lot of genes. So the GC content of the gene and the GC content of the genome are close. Not identical, but close. Fine? In fact, to be honest, I'm surprised that this is kind of asymmetrical. I expected to be more symmetrical. So there is something interesting in this genome. So let's make this thing. So we have the third function. Okay, let me be lazy and copy the function. That. In fact, I don't want to use the name sequence. What name can we use? I want to use a name. Because sec is already a word that we use. Sequence, they exist. Let's say DNA. Okay, I'm going to call DNA, and then I am going to take uppercase of DNA. Okay? That will be better because I don't want to change the input. The input, someone give me the input, I don't touch the input, okay? Fine. So yeah, DNA, it's a name that we use inside the function for whatever the user will send to us. Someone asked a question in the chat, no? Ah, okay, I see. Now I see what happened. Then we have this function. So we can calculate gene. This is the version 3. And here we cannot say 1 because it will be an error. We can say genome. Okay, not the super fast, but I have to tell you, this function that we make are mostly for teaching. We can make them faster. For real life, we will use something faster, but I'm using for teaching. Okay, I'm using simple thing. Everything that we can teach, someone did before. Okay, all the simple questions someone did before. But we are using them for teaching. So we can have the GC content of the genome of gene number one, the genes, this is plural, number one, or number 10. So this version is even more generic, even less specific. We can load, if you force me, let me go back to the function that we load the chromosome, and I will, instead of loading E. coli, I will load the other bacteria. What was the other bacteria? Carsonella AP, this one, the genome of this one, chromosomes. I'm also using chromosomes here, and I will say a genome, the second genome. So this is a shorter genome, and we can now say gene GC content of genome 2. Very low GC content, interesting. 16% of, so you see, we can even use in a completely different organism because the function is generic. The first version was only for the genes of E. coli, okay? The second answer. The third version is any DNA sequence, okay? Any DNA sequence, and you can apply anything, on anything. Now, just to finish here, I have a couple of more comments, but let's see. I wanted to do this. I want to say we've got the GC content of the genome of E. coli, and I want to use this to draw a line, an horizontal line, at this position, and color. I will make it red so we can see it clearly. And if take 1 second, there, you see. Can you see? I hope you can see the line is kind of thin, but you see the red line is the average of all the genome, and it's not exactly the center, it's because it's kind of asymmetrical. I mean, it compares, you have to compare this plot with the plot that we have in the slides here. No, this one. These are two views of the same thing. So let me give you a summary and we go for a break, okay? To create a function, we need to do something like this. And okay, the summary, this is a very short line, but we speak about two things. How to make a function, if you like, why to make a function, and how to use this function over vectors, okay? These are great. There are more versions. Well, you take a look at the help. I think we will use them a lot. Okay?